past 10 or 12 years, we've discovered that there are planets orbiting other stars. And in 1995, the first planet orbiting another star was found. And this was a totally open question, the most fundamental question about other stars. Do they have planets? We didn't know, and now we do. And we're actually, there was a recent detection of water vapor in the atmosphere of another planet. This is the first for that as well. So we're taking these steps towards answering this question. And in fact, in the 20th century, we started answering the question how the universe came to be. They discovered evidence for the Big Bang. And now there's tons of evidence for the Big Bang. And no serious astronomer really questions the Big Bang model of how the universe formed. And these may not impact your daily life, except Sagan mentioned this, or it might have been Asimov, I don't remember who it was, who said that imagine that the universe is teeming with life, or imagine that there are no aliens out there at all. Either way, that's a very interesting thing. And I think that right there tells you a lot about humans. If we're the only life in the universe, imagine how precious and small and rare we are. But if the universe is teeming with life, imagine what this brotherhood of species could be like for us. And these are fundamental questions that science is actually starting to answer. And these are the kind of questions that people are really interested in. And it gives you a sense of where we are. People want to label things. You know, when a kid first goes out and starts learning the names of the stars or what kind of rocks there are, the different kinds of insects and plants, they love it. They love going out and finding out what these names are and trying to find them all and name them themselves or whatever. We like to put things in categories, and we have no category for us. Humans don't fit in well with the universe. We don't know where our place is in the universe, and that's what science is trying to tell us. Science is a way of finding things out. It's a way of not fooling ourselves, as Richard Feynman said. But it's also a way of discovering the order of things and where things fit. And you know, religion is an attempt to do this as well. But science is using evidence and observation and discovery to do it. And I think if there's going to be an answer to this question, we're going to find it using the scientific method.
I'd like to let our listeners know that you can purchase a copy of Phil Plait's book, Bad Astronomy, through our website, pointofinquiry.org. Phil, I want to talk to you about religion as we finish up, but before we get there, you just talked about the search for extraterrestrial intelligence, or at least extraterrestrial life elsewhere in the universe. Where do you come out on that? Do you think there's life out there, not just on this planet?
I get this question a lot when I give public talks, and especially when I talk about things like the face on Mars, which I debunk, you know, showing that this giant rock on Mars looks like a face, but it's not actually supposed to be a face. It's just a random erosion feature. But I always get that question, do you believe in UFOs and do you believe in aliens? And I say no and yes, and that always baffles people. Do I think there's life in the universe? I don't know. There's no evidence for it. So I cannot say yes or no, and it's not really a matter of belief. It's a matter of does it exist or doesn't it? And if you want to ask, do I think it's out there, I would say that the odds are certainly in favor of that being true. We know how many stars there are in the galaxy. There are between 100 to 200 billion, something like that. We know that there are hundreds of billions of galaxies in the universe, each with hundreds of billions of stars. So you've got quadrillions. It's a big number. You got a lot of stars out there. How many of these have planets? Well, we don't know, but we're starting to find planets around the other stars, and we're finding that the conditions to make planets are pretty easy. Now, it's not easy to make Earths, but we know of one example, Earth, duh, and so we know it can happen. And so even if it's a tiny fraction multiplied by quadrillions is a big number. And so it seems like a pretty safe bet to assume that there are lots of Earths out there.
So given the likelihood of life out there, do you think there's much evidence that life has visited, that those kinds of life out there in the universe have visited us on this planet? It's a numbers game that there's probably, or at least possibly, life out there, but thousands of people each year report from the evidence of their own senses that aliens visited them. Do you think it follows that if it's likely life is out there, that it's also likely aliens are visiting us on this planet?
Well, that's actually two different questions. Have aliens ever visited us is one question, and are they coming now in the numbers quoted by the people who claim to have been visited? And, you know, the Earth's been around for 5 billion years, and roughly, and that's a long time. And that's a long time for life to have developed on another planet in the Milky Way galaxy. And you can imagine, I mean, the sun formed 5 billion years ago, but the galaxy itself is well over 10 billion years. So if some star, just like the sun, formed a million years earlier, you can imagine life on a planet forming a million years before ours did. And a million years is a long time. And if they developed interstellar travel and came here a million years ago, what evidence would there be? You know, none. So if there are aliens out there and they can go from planet to planet, maybe they have visited us in the past. I'm not gonna say no. But that's an entirely different question than are aliens coming to Earth in droves by the thousands and, you know, sexually probing people and carving the butts out of cows and doing all this other stuff that people claim. And it doesn't seem rational. We have explanations for things like this. People see Venus, they see the moon, they see satellites, they see meteors all the time and don't know what they're seeing because they're not familiar with the sky. And so there are tons and tons of UFO reports. What I show people, what I say to people is, there's a group of people who are looking up all the time, and those are amateur astronomers. There are thousands and thousands of them in the U.S. alone, and yet they very, very rarely report flying saucers, and that's because they know what they're looking at when they see a satellite or Venus or whatever. And so you have to realize that the vast majority of sightings of these things are simply misidentified mundane objects like helicopters or whatever. And so I think that discounts most of these right away. For people who claim to have had a close encounter of the third kind, physical contact, you can show that there's all sorts of psychological reasons why people think this. Some people, you know, there's this hypnagogic suggestion, this sort of half-dream, half-awake state you can be in where you swear things are real but they're not. You can affect the temporal lobe with magnetic fields, and it makes people feel like they're in the presence of some sort of higher being. There's all these sorts of things that seem to me to be far more likely what's going on than aliens coming here. Because if they're coming all this way, and yet we're not seeing them except when they're picking people up, and they seem to do this half-assed job of making people forget that they were there in the first place, it just doesn't hang together. And that's one of the many reasons I don't think that UFOs are visiting us.
I want to finish up right now talking about the public investment in space science. Before we get to the big doozy, the big question about religion, let's talk about public policy, space science. It doesn't get a big chunk of our national budget, but some people, oddly enough, maybe not surprisingly, astronomers argue that our investment in space science pays dividends like investment in other things doesn't really pay. Can you give me some examples of why we should be, as a society, much more concerned about space science than we are now?
Well, space science has a vast, vast impact on your daily life. People don't even realize that. You get up and you watch the Weather Channel or the local weather. Well, where do you think those satellite pictures are coming from? Hello, satellites, right? That's space. That's exploring space. To be able to put a satellite in orbit around the Earth, you have to understand the near-Earth environment. You have to understand the radiation that's going on out there. You have to understand gravity. You have to understand what effects a satellite can be under when it's up there. So hurricane prediction, tornado prediction, although tornadoes are done from the ground a lot, you need to have a more global view of the supercell and the thunderstorm coming in that you get from satellites, communication satellites. We have to understand how the sun works. Because when the sun ejects a solar flare, or what's called a coronal mass ejection, which is basically a violent explosion from the sun that shoots subatomic particles, if those things hit us, they can have incredible effects on the Earth. They can blast satellites. They can blow them out of the sky. Just, well, not literally, but they can fry the satellite, destroy the electronic circuitry.